Today is January 1st, so it's the beginning of a new year and a new decade. It also happens to be a Wednesday, so a midweek Muse video day too. A new beginning kind of day such as this deserves a fabulous new product, and I'm excited to show you our new white, smooth, and sturdy cardstock. It's what these three new disc-bound journals are cut from, and in today's video, I'll show you how awesome this paper is for art journaling. I named this paper smooth and sturdy because those are the two major characteristics of it. The really smooth surface makes it ideal for gel printing and all kinds of art journal techniques, including, as you can see here, actually writing on it. It's pretty thick, equivalent to about 140-pound cover weight, so it's going to stand up to whatever you throw at it. And when you throw things at it, it'll accept all kinds of wet media, and there's a coating on there that actually will allow alcohol ink and alcohol pearls to bloom a bit. Today we're debuting three disc-bound journals that feature this paper, 3x4, 6x6, and 6x9, and they're all introductory priced at 20% off. When you work with pages like these, and I'm going to show you how to put them together, but I'll show you how easily these come apart. Bam, it's out, you can work on it. And that's the major advantage over something like a regular binding, whether it's spiral or stitched or whatever it is. You can take the pages out, do your thing, and when they're dry, go ahead and put them back in. I hear people ask me about covers for these journals, and one of the reasons that we don't include a quote-unquote cover is because people expect covers to be really thick and heavy. When that happens, you can't actually get this opening to flex properly around the discs, or if it does, it ends up creasing and it's not very nice looking. So my solution is to take two pages and use a dry adhesive like score tape and glue them together. At that point, you'll have something that's thick enough to really identify as a cover, but it'll still flex to go around the disc, so that kind of works. I showed you how to take a page out. Let me show you how easy it is to kind of start this from scratch. And since I have the other two sizes, I'm going to work on a 4x4. So the first thing you have to do is get the discs on one page or the other. Once I get to that point, I'm going to turn this page over, and you can see that the page length flat kind of makes the discs stand up straight, which makes putting this other page on a little bit less fiddly. And once you get the first two pages on, the whole fiddly thing really does go away. It's just a question of snapping the notches down on top of the discs, and bam, you're done. That's it. I'm going to bring back in the 6x6 for 1 second. One of the things that I think is important that you should know, aside from how easy it is to put these back on, is that we have spaced the discs in such a way, or spaced the notches in such a way, that all of these pages fit. So I could take 6x6 pages and put them in the 6x9. I could take 3x4s and put them in there. So you can really combine these any way that you want. And the notch system here is identical to the notch version of the watercolor disc-bound journals and the black smooth and sturdy paper too. So intermix, mix your media, have a really good time. These are 1-inch discs, which is what the 6x6 and the 6x9 are going to come packed with. The kits that we include, what we include in the kits that are labeled as journals, will actually have additional pages available also that won't have any discs. So these are 1-inch discs, and I would say you could comfortably fit between 25 and 30 pages on them. And as I said, the spacing's identical, so you can mix and match to your heart's content. Now, I tested a lot of papers when I was trying to find something that worked well for these kind of applications, and when I settled on this, it was because A, it was very smooth and it was sturdy, but also because it played nicely with all kinds of media. So I have three colors of Distress Oxide sprays that I'm going to shake up, and then I'm just going to show you, this is kind of my go-to technique when I do this. I'm going to put a little bit of each color down. I'm going to spritz a little bit of water in it, and then I'm just going to dip my pages into it. This is kind of my version of Tim Holtz's Distress Wrinkle-Free technique, and I especially like this with oxide sprays. So I'm just going to put this in and tap. Now, you can see that I've got distinct color sections on there. If I want to meld them a little bit, I can turn this around. So there's one. I can do another one. I can add a little bit more water if I want to stretch this a little further and I want to lighten that color a little bit on there, but I think that this is pretty much fine the way that it is. So you can get all different kinds of looks this way, and I think that that's one of the real brilliant parts of this technique, is that you can get big swaths of color like this, or you can get smaller ones like this. All right, let me slide this out of the way for 1 second and just wipe this up, because I do want to show you one other thing. So 2020 on the Chinese zodiac calendar is the year of the rat. Let me bring these in, and hopefully my fingers are clean. And what I've done is created three collage sheets that feature 2020 with some really cute rats on it, like what you see here. And then I have some individual rats. So someplace in here is the cover that I did, if I could actually find it. Where did I put it? All right, so it's managed to vanish. I'll find it when I come. Oh, here it is. Good grief. So here's kind of what I've done. Now, I haven't decided if I'm going to make this my cover yet, but if I want to, all I have to do is adhere another page to it if I want it thicker, and then I'll be good to go. So this page was printed on a gel press plate. That's how I have this kind of blue thing going on in the background. Up next, I'm going to show you a couple of quick ways to add background color and pattern. Gel printing on the smooth and sturdy pages provides really nice detailed results, and of course the fact that you can work on the pages independently of the bound book just makes things so much easier. So one of the ways that I like to put background, pattern, and color on is to use what I think of as a two-step process. The first is to lay down a more or less solid background, and then I'm going to reprint over the top of that with a layer of paint that I'm going to manipulate with a stencil. Now, the only difference between these two pages is the fact that my initial layer was an ombre of two colors. Here, it was just a single color, and then I used a single color with, obviously, two different stencils to create the top layer. So let me bring in my gel press plate. I have my 8x10 plate. It's pretty dirty at the moment, but it'll get the job done. So I'm going to start with a blend of buff and ocean, just because I don't have anything that's kind of light blue nearby. I just want to tint this buff with a little bit of ocean. I like my background to be reasonably light, or I need to make certain that what I'm going to put on top of it is quite dark. So I'm just going to blend this a little bit and go ahead and get the color brayered out on the plate. Now, if I want to, I could really blend the heck out of this and smooth out the darker color here where I first moved the ocean, but I'm gonna leave that because sometimes that can make for an interesting pattern. So let me put my hands on a 6x6 page, since I didn't actually put enough paint out to do a 6x9. I'm just gonna go ahead and place this on here, grab a scrap piece of paper, and go ahead and print that solid background. Okay, so you can see that I did get a little bit of pattern from the color where it didn't move. I'm going to very lightly just wipe this off so that I don't mix what's going on here. Ordinarily, I would probably have pulled a ghost print, but for this particular one, I didn't. So I'm just going to dry this off enough so I can come back in and work. Now, this is going to be, by the time I get to it, that page will be dry enough. So what I'm going to do now is grab a stencil, and this is our scalloped, This is our scalloped rose stencil, and it's what I'm going to use to pattern the paint. Because I want a darker color, I'm going to come in with Dina Wakley's. This is Blackberry, and I think I might grab a little bit, because I'm in a blending mood, I'm going to put a little bit of fuchsia with it, just so that it ends up a little bit redder. But this time I'm going to blend the colors enough so that I don't get any streaks. I don't want to kind of mix my message. I don't want to confuse the pattern of the stencil with any kind of weird blending that's going on here. So I'm going to lay this on, and I'm using a fairly large amount of paint because I want this layer to be opaque enough to go ahead and cover up some of that background. All right, that looks pretty good. Wipe my finger off. All right. Oops, paper falling all over the place here. So I'm going to probably do this twice. I want to be certain that I remove enough paint from the openings of the stencil that what is underneath, when I pull that out, will actually show. So that lighter version of the ocean color will show through the stencil openings. All right, let's see how that looks. All right, that should be good. So let's take this off, bring this back in. Put it face down, grab another piece of paper, and go ahead and print this. Oops. There you go. That's it. That's how simple this is. Now, obviously, it's always harder to do something when you're demoing to actually get it to come out the way that you want, but you can see the effect that's going on here. And if I get this plate out of the way, and I bring back in the journal, you can see I got a similar effect here it's a question of how much paint are you going to lay down. So this, I think that this works just fine. I have the effect that I want. So the other way that this smooth paper really works is to lend itself to lettering and writing. Well, I guess it would help if I turned this so it was facing you. So you can see that it's super easy to write on here, unlike our watercolor pages, which I still love, but they are, there's enough texture on them because they're cold press as opposed to hot, that it's not nearly as smooth as this is. And someplace along here, there is some other lettering. You can see that I came in with a white gel pen and I kind of did some embellishing in there. Is there any more? There's a little bit here. This was done with another gel pen. Again, I just came in and I used a gel pen to kind of make some white dash marks in those open areas. This is our organic rounds mask or something along those lines. Of course, I can't remember. And then if I bring the large journal back in, if I can remember where I put it, again, you can see that lots of lettering going on here. And because the paper is so smooth, it comes out and it works really well. Whether I'm using something like a Posca PC1MR or a Pitt pen, if I could put my hands on, which I can't. But these are the two things that I've used so far, and the results are really, really good.